So this is, what is week one? Week one, anthropology. All the students are going to tell you what they learned this week. We did lessons on archaeology and hominids and primates that won't be involved, but they picked up favorite topics of other themes. So I'll let them go.
Which is mostly just like items people make to, like that goes into like the traditions of like their country. In this class, we did this thing called close looking, which is basically where we had different objects and we observed them. So first, and like from different cultures, and we were trying to like figure out where each item was from. At one point we got a basket that had a specific type of weaving, which we then narrowed down to being a gwalar or gichi.
Gullagichi.
Gullagichi. Which is from the coast of South Carolina and Georgia, and it comes from African American and like slave culture. And we also got a small elephant figurine that was like yellow and it was from Kenya.
Language is the primary form of communication that can be written, spoken, and signed.
Linguists study language and pay attention to what is said and how it is said.
Most of us know that humans have an advanced form of communication. What most of you don't know is that this is caused by a mutated gene called FOXP2, which explains why humans can speak but chimps cannot.
Moving on. Acculturation is the process of which a child learns their culture. One of the ways this can occur is through language.
One must become familiar with certain metaphors, including hot, heated, hot-headed, in order to fully understand their language.
Continuing on to animals, they can communicate through signals, chemicals called pheromones, and tactiles. Primates use call signals to signify danger, mating calls, and food.
And bees communicate in many ways. One of our favorites is their dancing. They dance the waggle dance to signify nectar more than 50 meters away, and the round dance to signify nectar less than 50 meters away.
Now you know about our personal favorites of the field of anthropology.
Thank you for watching our presentation.
Thank you.
Focus on the category of genetics and mutations, which is a subcategory of what biological anthropologists did. The definition of a mutation is a change in genetic code that creates entirely new genetic material, and they can be harmful to an individual's health, but also even benign or sometimes beneficial. And a specific example of this would be cystic fibrosis. It's a condition that creates thick mucus and stops pancreatic ducts and blocks them, which stops the digestive enzymes from getting into the digestive system, which stops humans from breaking down food. This happened from a mutated gene called CFTR, and it's a hereditary disorder, which can then cause breathing problems, malnutrition, and chronic lung disease.
Changes a protein in red blood cells called hemoglobin into a sickle shape. It can be an example of a harmful genetic mutation. It reduces the ability to carry oxygen throughout the bloodstream, which often decreases the life expectancy of those who are affected. It can also be helpful to the individual. Those who carry it actually gain protection against malaria. The membranes of these cells are stretched by their unusual shape and become porous, causing the nutrients essential to the parasite's survival to leak out. With the organism already working diligently to eliminate the faulty cells, the parasites are quickly destroyed with them. Many genetic mutations also have no effect on the organisms they appear in, such as PTC. PTC is a gene found in plants that causes them to taste bitter, but only if the consumer has a protein in their genetics that works as a taste receptor on the tongue. Over time, as it was needed less to avoid bitter-tasting toxic compounds, the gene required to taste PTC mutated, leaving 25% of the population unable to detect bitter taste of broccoli or cilantro citrus flavor.
Another genetic mutation are dimples. Dimples are an indent in the cheek. Some people have one and some people have two. Dimples are the result of a muscle in the cheek splitting into two. Around 20 to 30% of the world's population has dimples, making them uncommon. Freckles are also an example of genetic mutation. Freckles begin with a mutation of the gene MC1R, which regulates pigment. This results in freckled faces. Only about 4 to 5% of the world's population has freckles, making them very rare. Hopefully, our presentation has cleared up any confusion on mutations and made you interested in your own genetics. Raise your hand if you had ice cream this afternoon. Okay, many of us did. And I'm sure some of us may have a lactose intolerant reaction to this ice cream, no matter how severe. Much of the world's population has this lactose intolerance. This is one of the examples of biocultural anthropology. That's something we learned about this week, and it's how our human culture affects our biological genes.
Certain populations are more tolerant to individual environmental factors, which, influenced by the culture and genetic makeup of the community. Biological anthropology emphasizes the biocultural approach. This is the concept that human biology and culture are very closely related and have influenced each other throughout history.
Mammals don't typically consume dairy after infancy, but drinking dairy is a common practice for humans far into adulthood for many. Populations with a history of keeping dairy herds are usually more lactose tolerant, such as people in Europe and Africa. The discovery of fire has allowed humans to cook food, which makes it softer and easier to chew. This has made wisdom teeth pretty much useless in modern times. Nowadays, wisdom teeth are occurring less frequently as a result.
In conclusion, there are a lot of things that we do today that, like, in our culture that's perceived as normal that affects, like, our anatomy and how, like, we evolve as people. And so, like, our culture affects our biological, like, makeup and how we have moved forward throughout history.
So this
anthropology, there's gross observation, which is the fieldwork portion that makes up the lower percent of what anthropologists actually do.
Yeah, it's where you observe using your eyes, basically.
We'll identify the sex of a skeleton by observing the pelvic structure or the cranium and vaginal pelvis. You can identify age by the dental development, like how many teeth you have, the sutures in the skull, and how they are.
Yeah. Yep.
And the number of individuals, it's really important to discern this, and you can tell that basically there are two of the same bone, you probably have two different individuals.
Lab analysis is the majority of archaeological work, including cross-referencing databases to identify remains of DNA, dental records, and medical records.
So basically, when you cross-reference with databases, you pull DNA and then go through DNA databases, see if it's kept down anywhere, see if you can get a match for dental records too, because most people go to the dentist in their lifetime. Medical records as well, if there's any pronounced trauma on the skeleton.
Collaboration with other departments, the chemistry and biological and local authorities would be three main ones. And why would you say, and why these chemistry? Well, if you are, if there's like a substance or DNA, we can use the DNA today.
If there's a substance found on the bones and you don't know what it is, you can call up the resident chemistry department and they'll help you out with that. Biology, that's kind of your skeleton. You need to consult people in the biological field to figure out who it might be. Mm-hmm. And local authorities would be, well, if you find a skeleton, you probably have to call someone, and the FBI is usually involved in investigations and such. And for facial reconstruction, there's this interesting practice where people can reconstruct faces
using like clay and models and stuff like that.
Yeah, they can figure it out using the structure of the skull.
Just for the reference.
This focuses on identifying individuals based on your biological profile. You can identify a person through their teeth, through their age. You want to identify their age. Their teeth are they're going to be the most practical thing to use when identifying a person's age. You can see how many teeth have come in. There's not really many changes between the ages of 2 and 4, so you'd estimate if they only have certain teeth, you'd estimate their age between them. But if they have premolars or molars or wisdom teeth coming in, you can assume that their age is older. And then you can also use their skull as a way to identify their age. If they have a soft spot, which hasn't closed up, you can identify that it's a younger person, or if their different skull sutures haven't fused, different ages for them.
Skull sutures are the parts of your skull that are, they're sort of like plates, like tectonic plates, that over time there's ridges in between them, so the skull isn't completely full, so the brain can grow and expand. Once your brain is done growing, it'll close up. You can tell someone's age by how closed all their sutures are.
If you wanted to identify their ethnicity, it's very hard to do without a full skull. But if you see over here, the top is female, the bottom is male, and it shows the different ethnicities. People of African descent normally have wider nasal canals. Asian is a little bit more narrow, but European or Caucasians have the most narrow nasal canals. And then you can also tell by their skull shape if they have a forehead slant, their mandible size, and the structure of their teeth. And then if you wanted to tell sex, you could use the pelvic shape. So a male's pelvis is going to be normally more round and more narrow, and then a female's pelvis is going to be a lot more wide. Then you can also look at different elements of the skull. Females are normally just smaller and slimmer in shape, and males are going to be more like protruding.
Two things when identifying the cause of death. The first one being what the marks look like from certain weapons, and then if the marks on the bones are from humans or animals. Usually animal marks are either from the animal gnawing on the bone or scavenger marks, while human-made marks are from weapons such as knives or bullets, so they're a lot cleaner and more uniform. The top row is a skull that has suffered a gunshot wound, and you can see the wound, or you can see the mark right above the eye socket, and it's going from the top to the back, and you can see the entrance wound in the left picture and the exit in the middle and right, and it's very clean as opposed to what an animal mark would look like. And then the bottom pictures are another male human skull from a sharp force trauma, and you can see that the skull is broken and fragmented, and only the majority of it is remaining.
So there's also a lot of forensic facial reconstruction that is done in this field. So as we saw earlier, from just your bones and even just your skull, you can tell a lot about a person. You can also tell a lot about their face, because even though it's mostly like flesh here, all of those structures on your face are all based on the bone. So you can tell things like how far apart your eyes are, how like big your nose is, how sharp or like flat your chin is, or you don't have a cleft chin either. Tell a lot of things from just their face. So with the right expert who has a lot of anatomical knowledge, you can pretty accurately recreate a face. Although there's some things you still can't determine, like if that person ate a lot, had a very fatty diet, had a lot of fat on their face, you wouldn't be able to tell that from just their skull. But the process is sort of like this. You start with a basic like recreation of the skull. You don't want to use the actual skull because you probably don't have a perfect, like fully full skull. And you don't want to put a ton of clay on that either. And you want to add the eyes first, they'll be placed correctly, and then you have kind of markers all over it to put in, determine how deep the tissue. How deep the tissue is going to be, that's determined through a lot of different factors. Like, if you have any samples, you know they have a very, very rich diet, they were high class, they had a lot of food, you can tell they'll might have they have more meat on their bones, pretty much. Or if you have a cast of their body, like in Pompeii, their flesh rotted away after they recovered, so you could tell exactly how much like flesh they would have. If you don't have none of those, a lot of other outside records could be used, like ethnicity data, just general data about their similar people. So after you get it, they'll start using strips of clay. They'll act as tissue and they'll fill around the space around the markers. This will continue to go on, and then features around the eyes and the lips are filled in. And finally, smooth down all the clay and add details like facial asymmetry, scars and wounds, and facial hair. Facial hair is another thing you can't really tell from just a skull. Very difficult, but you can usually make easy assumptions if they're male or if they're like living in a colder environment or living in a culture where facial hair is important. But yeah, this is our presentation. I'll be learning more about forensic